Welcome back. Hey, we have to book Eddie Brill, Alex.
And he lives in walking distance.
Yeah.
He's five blocks from here.
Why haven't we had Eddie Brill on the show?
Why?
I mean, it's insane. He used to do the show all the time. You know it. Now, Eddie used to book the comics for Letterman. By the way, let me introduce Jon Fisch.
Hello. I was his last new comic.
Really?
Or I might have been his last comic. Yeah.
And then he got fired because of you.
That because of me. Joe Matarese was so nice. He texted me. He goes, that set was so great. They should give Eddie his job back.
Well, we have New York stand-up royalty in this room. I didn't realize that both Corey Kahaney and
we're in that club.
Jon Fisch not only have done Letterman, but you've done Stephen Colbert. That speaks volumes because you would think they... Well, anyway, that's quite an accomplishment.
Yeah, I'm proud of it.
And I'm proud to have the two of you on the show because
I thought your set was great, John.
Thanks, you too.
Let me give
yours was like stressful too because you had to do like a it seemed
live.
Like a political live thing.
I did it during the
right?
during the, the Republican convention.
Yeah.
In Cleveland or back in New York?
He was doing live shows in studio during the Republican convention. So I went on, I went on that show. So it was live. He taped it, at whatever, 12:40 at night.
People don't realize, the chops that takes, When it goes well, they're like, oh, yeah, it's easy for comics to do. But it's like,
no.
It takes
so
somebody that's been, that's a veteran, that's done, dozens of TV sets,
It was stressful, but it was still fine.
It was live.
Yeah.
Was it political?
Yeah. That's also my savvy. I sent them a political set, and I said, "What do you think?" That's the sechel, the smarts. I just sent them. I knew the set they would want, and I sent it, and they said, "Yeah, we'd love you to do it." And that was it.
But that's hard because that's not necessarily what you would do if you picked five at that time from your act.
Right. But I'm actually working on something that I'd really love to do on Colbert again, which is sort of about the future of healthcare. Like I think those kind of things are intriguing to them.
Mm-hmm. And you're a political. You're pretty.
No, I had two political jokes. I built a set around it.
Okay. Jon Fisch is a stand-up comedian. He's appeared on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert and The Late Show with David Letterman. He's been featured in Maxim magazine. You've seen him on Last Comic Standing, season 4. He was the host of the wildly popular podcast. What was the wildly popular?
I don't know. Is it widely or wildly? I never knew. I think it's different in each of my bios.
And what is the popular podcast? What is it?
I did this podcast called In the Tank.
Right.
It was years ago, and it was it was comedy talk. Comedy talk.
Get
before
it? Fish
it was,
tank.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, John too. There's a tank and a John.
Yeah.
Oh, true.
So I immediately thought John.
The other.
It was a pun on.
I had friends that were like 3 years into the podcast were like would text me like, I just got it.
Jon Fisch.
I usually try not to be too on the nose, but that one I didn't get on the nose enough.
Jon Fisch hosted a podcast called In the Tank. What years were you doing that?
I think we were maybe 07 or 09.
My God.
In the 09 to maybe 09 to, yeah, that definitely in that area. It was real start of the podcast scene.
And who'd you do it with?
My buddy Dan Allen was the producer, and my buddy Dan Shackey was like the funny third mic sidekick.
I know Dan Shackey's brother Jackie, the comedian. Jackie Shackey?
Oh.
Hey,
I
kill me.
Her.
This is just...
Is that somebody? Is that a real person?
No.
He started with the puns. I can't start is the problem. I cannot start. So, yes, your other TV appearances include Comedy Central's Premium Blend, been on VH1's Celebrity Apprentice.
Yeah.
Three Men and a Chick Flick on the WE Network, and you were the host. You were on Celebrity Apprentice.
Yeah, I got to update this bio. We did a show you know, that one of their the celebrities' things was that they were had to put on a show, and you know, obviously to you know raise enough money, or whoever raised more money won or whatever. And we were it was kind of a cool experience, but for the actual show, we were sort of a real afterthought because you know, in order for them to like get a lot of money, the celebrities exhausted their celebrity contacts, and so like our show ended up being Jimmy Fallon doing a song with this country singer who was super nice.
What were you doing?
We were supposed to be three of us on each team. So I think I was on a team with...
So you weren't a celebrity?
No. We were the comedians.
Who were booked.
Part of their teams, yeah.
Uh-huh.
And I think Rachel Feinstein was on it, and Wally Collins, and Jessica Carson, and...
That's a good show.
It was a good show.
And what celebrities were you? Who were you working with?
Well, LaToya Jackson was the team leader.
Hmm.
And I had to ask her for permission to go to the Gap to get a new shirt.
Okay.
Because I only had one black shirt that didn't have a logo. And when we asked her what we should wear for the appearance, she said, "I see you all in black."
I was on the regular Apprentice.
Oh, really? Oh, wow.
Yeah. I caused the team to lose.
What happened?
It was, he really threw me under the bus, Trump. And
you met Trump?
No, but I didn't meet him, but they, you know, he said, you booked a... He said, you booked a comic who dropped the F-bomb, and they didn't like it. And so, you know, I think you have to bear the responsibility of it. And the
you were the comic who used the F-bomb?
Well, let me... I did a golf open, and I was doing a golf joke. I have one golf joke. And the joke is, you guys play golf, and they say yes. And I say, you spend $250,000 a year to stand in the woods and say fuck. And it's a great...
That
it
is
kills,
a great joke. That's
it's a great joke. It's not a fuck joke.
Right.
And I actually got a big laugh, but they blamed that joke for losing. The next day, Joy Behar though talked about it on The View, defended me,
yes,
and put me on the phone, and I explained you know what happened, and she was really.
What year was this?
I'm gonna say I don't know. It was before Celebrity. Celebrity Apprentice came after The Regular Apprentice,
yeah.
So I think it was the year before you.
Oh, okay.
And who did you meet, Jon Fisch?
Well, there was Meatloaf. There was.
I don't want to know what they served. I want to know. By the way, Corey,
he
is
had
a
meltdown on that. I think
he had a meltdown.
Yeah, well. I'm blanking on the country singer, but I think it's Jon Ritchie. Is that
okay?
Is any country fans here? He was super sweet and nice and great. And then Lil Jon was the other guy on our team. Yeah,
okay.
Those three. Yeah, but so they ended up like getting Fallon. So, like, we all ended up doing, like, 2 or 3 minutes of comedy.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fun. And, like, Kevin Kline and Phoebe Cates were in the audience. Yeah, we had some... Yeah. But it was, you know...
And they were raising money for charity.
Yes.
So if it's Trump, as we all know, when you raise money for, like, children's cancer...
They take it.
You keep it.
Yeah. It's great.
Did you read about this?
I just saw a headline on Twitter that he like, is... kept money.
Well, I know he didn't actually make the donation to the veterans when he swore that he would do that, you know, from Mar-a-Lago, right?
Mm-hmm.
But this cancer thing's new.
The cancer thing is apparently one of the idiot kids decided to have a fundraiser for children's cancer. One of the idiot kids claims to be very involved with St. Jude's, which is a great organization. St. Jude's turns nobody away. So what one of the idiot sons did is he held this golf tournament at one of the Trump golf resorts and said all the proceeds will go to St. Jude. So it was done without St. Jude really knowing about this. They just used St. Jude.
The Trumps are like sketchy comedy producers.
Yeah. So they got everybody to cough up, you know, 20 grand, and they were using the name St. Jude's. And so, I'll be a part of this. It's going to St. Jude's. And Donald said, you cannot use my golf course to raise money for St. Jude's. We have to get money for this. You have to pay the fee. You know, I'm not giving this to St. Jude's. So the Trump kid had to pay to use the Trump golf course in order to do the fundraiser for St. Jude's. And they got bilked. They're hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Oh, so some money did end up going to St. Jude's.
No.
None.
Wow. It costs more money
to rent the place
than.
But that is the misnomer of a lot of these fancy fundraisers in New York City. I mean, where you see them all the time, and they're charging $250 a person, but it's at the Plaza or it's at the Waldorf, and when they're done with it, they really are only ending up with like $20 a person. In terms, it was just an excuse to throw the big party, to have the big party, to plan the big party, and the donations often are very, very small.
And also to get the people on their mailing list, so hopefully they'll be recurring.
Yes, and then they do the auction is where they really try to make the money. Where they try to upsell and make people embarrassed and donate. But this stuff happens all the time. I mean, he's right. A lot of comedians have been caught doing this. There was a comedian on a ship who was I'm not going to say the name, who was selling his CDs, and he said, but if you want to buy one for the troops, you can buy a second one, and I'll ship it to the troops. And apparently, like, the next day, he just took those CDs that were going to the troops, and he sold those.
Well, maybe he goes home and mails them to the troops.
Maybe. Could be.
Maybe.
Maybe.
People are bad. Some people are bad.
Yeah.
Trump is just bad. Yeah. I worked on the Comedy Central roast of Donald Trump, and I have it from good authority. He said he didn't need the money. He was doing the roast for Comedy Central for charity.
Right. Well, he said it on the air.
Right. I have it on good authority that they never found out where he sent the money, that he didn't give it to charity. That is the current commander-in-chief.
I would love, and all the Trump supporters would probably, I'd love to hear them explain that one away. Well, he's a busy man. He has a lot going on.
What are you libtards worried about? Come on.
You count every dollar? You count every dollar? You don't know.
What are we going to do without him? When he has a stroke, that's the only way. He's going to have a massive stroke. So
you think?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, after the initial celebratory phase, I guess we just settle in and get life back, right?
Are we going to miss him?
No. That's my thing is that, like, how do these people that support, like, did you like him ever? Like, he's just not a good person. He's never been somebody that I've been like, I remember when I did Celebrity Apprentice, people were like, did you meet him? I'm like, no, like, I didn't even think to want to, you know, like, he's not like a person that I would like to meet.
I think in the very beginning when he would say some of those, you know, inflammatory things, there was a big smile on my face. Of like, that is hilarious that this guy can do this.
Yes.
And, you know, and good for him that he speaks his mind, not thinking that that's what everyone wanted. And, you know, I kind of enjoyed the entertainment.
What's scarier, that he is who he is or that so many people like that?
I think a lot of people are in a bubble and they're not affected by anything he does, including the poor people who voted for him. They're in a bubble and there's really nothing they can gain or lose by a national election. At least that's what they figure. That's, you know, so they just want to see something funny on the TV. I don't know.
They got it.
I also think that Michael Moore, the thing that he did, the five reasons why Trump is going to win. Remember that? He published that? Well, he had the breakdown of all the reasons why and my favorite one was number four. When you get in that booth and you're all by yourself, there's going to be people who say, I just want to see what's going to happen. And I do think a lot of people fall into that category.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which is why he shouldn't have that red button, Trump, because
he's one of those people.
He's one of those people.
I just want to see what happens.
I just want to see, does it really work? I mean, if I press it, it really, what happens? Do you think he could launch a nuclear attack?
No, I don't think so. I don't think he would.
No, what I'm saying is, do you think he can? As in, do you think he can pick up the phone and say, I want you to nuke this? Rosie is up in the Hamptons. We have the coordinates. I want a mid-sized
nuclear weapon truck.
You know, it's like that's the stuff that's beyond my realm. Like, I could never imagine that happening for real. So it's like, I couldn't imagine anybody doing it, but like, I guess if someone is, yeah, he would be.
Does he have to clear it through Mattis or McMaster? I mean, he just can't order a nuclear airstrike, right? So yeah, the safest place to be during a nuclear.
I don't know, I feel like we need a civics expert here explain.
I don't think
What is it? You have to have the generals there. You got to have. I mean, there's. Jeff Sessions, although he's so afraid of him now.
I don't think anybody would obey his order. I just think
I don't know. We have no idea what really goes on.
What happens? Well, it is bad. Things are really bad, and they're going to get worse. I'm being glib. The economy is bad. They say it's good, but it's bad, right?
Well, I think the thing that is going to be bad is if something does happen, an impeachment or he is removed from power, we are going to take a dive in the stock market. And so everyone who has retirement, savings and accounts and all of these people are going to say, you see, he was much better for the country.
I don't think that many people have money in the stock market. I think it's mostly institutions. I don't think that many people.
Every dime I have is in Cheesecake Factory. I think that's the way to go.
And that's just a sandwich from the Cheesecake Factory in the freezer.
I called my people. I said the lines are crazy. I want every dime on Cheesecake Factory.
I'm just impressed you have people.
The Cheesecake Factory is pretty amazing. In L.A., they had one.
They keep opening them. Everywhere I go, there's a new one.
And it's not about the cheesecake.
No, cheesecake's terrible.
It's about the portions.
It's the portions. And they have a burrito there. I haven't eaten there since I moved from LA.
I also think with the whole climate change, this is another opportunity for investing. I think that countries that wouldn't ordinarily have air conditioning are going to need it. So this is the time, like whatever company would sell air conditioners to Canada, this is a good time to invest.
I think it's a good time to invest in cruise ships.
Oh, because it's the only safe vacation you can take?
Well, have you worked a cruise ship?
I have not.
I'm figuring that Pruitt and Rex Spillerton, when they think of climate change, they go, we go on cruises. It's fantastic. So I could live on a cruise. Could you live on a cruise ship for the rest of your life?
I'd prefer not to. But, you're absolutely right. Now they can do the Northeast Passage. They can actually go from Alaska to Montreal because of global warming. The ice caps have shifted and they couldn't do that before.
All right, so if there's massive flooding, I was reading that 40% of Florida is in danger of just being underwater. Now, I love some people from Florida. But 40% of, we're going to lose 40% of Florida.
But doesn't that mean Manhattan's going to go under too?
Well, can I at least enjoy 40% of Florida disappearing?
<Which 40? laughs>
Unfortunately, the counties that went for Gore in 2000. I'm curious, could people say, we'll build these massive floating... I mean, have you seen some of these cruise ships?
I've never been on one, but I was doing that Aruba gig with Ray Ellen, and we drove by where, like, six of them were docked.
They're cities.
And I could not believe how large
they are. Cities.
They were... I've heard things like... I remember Tom Cotter was on one when Ted Alexandro was on with like Lewis Black or something, and they just met one night and they were like, what are you doing here? And he's like, well, I'm the cruise comic on this side. Like two comics that know each other well didn't know they were on the same ship.
Like, so you can put like 25,000 people on a cruise ship, right?
No,
I don't know.
No, that's too many. I think right now the max is 6,000.
But there's one that's just...
That's it. That's
like an aircraft carrier.
That's the 6,000 one.
What about
a lot of people, though. That's a lot of people. I mean, if one person gets sick and it's a foodborne illness, it's dangerous, very dangerous.
But there's, what about Dr., what's his name? From the Love Boat. Capel.
Yeah.
Right? Capel?
I love that guy.
Those doctors they work from 10 to 11 in the morning and from 3 to 4. I mean, I've been on ships, so I know.
Is there really a doctor on the boat?
Has to be.
Yeah.
Yeah. Matter of fact, they can take off without the captain. They can't take off without the doctor.
Wow.
And what does he do?
He basically he mans the morgue. There's always dead people on the ship.
Really? Like from the trip, people, or like they're going from one place to another.
There's always a death, and I'm told it's always within the first 24 hours.
Wow.
Somebody died, and they can't stop, so they have a morgue. You know.
So don't have the shrimp cocktail, because that ice is probably.
Is that in the pamphlet? We have a 300 seat comedy club and a morgue.
Well, you know, they do these cheesy tours where you get to see the galley. And I was like, do they ever show the morgue in these tours, in these behind-the-scenes tours?
What else do they have that, like, is like that under that category?
Listen, you hear stories. Yeah. I mean,
They're registered in Libya. They're never registered in America, which means the crew can commit crimes and then be tried in Libya.
Yeah, but you have to adhere to certain laws. When you dock in New York, you know, they come on and they inspect and they want to make sure things are...
Listen, I'd rather have them adhere to Libyan laws than the laws in Manhattan. I think they're more likely to be enforced.
Judge Judy lives on a cruise. She has an apartment on the World Cruise. The World Cruise is a condominium that is 12 months a year at sea. And you, if you own a condominium on it, you join the ship where, you know, you look it up. Okay, they're going to be in Monte Carlo. We'll fly there. We'll stay on for a couple of months.
What people have, it's another animal. Yeah. They're not human. The kind of life that certain people lead. Judge Judy, it's a condominium, so it's like an apartment on a ship.
And there's a full-time staff person that takes care of her condominium.
You know that movie The Diner or Diner?
We were just talking about it.
Me and my dad always go over that scene where what's his name? Daniel Stern. I forget if he's talking to Paul Reiser or not, but they're just, one of them is like, you ever get the feeling that there's a whole other world out there that we just don't know about?
Yes!
Something like that.
I love that.
There's so many times that happens to me, and that was one of them just now. It's just like, I could have died without knowing that.
About
the
morgue?
Yeah, I would know about the condominium thing. Like, I have, that just would never come into my sphere.
Right. And here, I work for a guy who had an amazing house. I used to go up there. And the first time I went up, it was designed by Stanford White, or is it Sanford White? It was Stanford White. He was the one who was murdered in Ragtime. It was the only house designed by Sanford White in California. It was a masterpiece. By the way, Alex, did you see Dick Cavett is selling his house in the Hamptons? $56 million, and it was designed by Stanford White.
Wow.
And it burnt down, and he rebuilt it to spec. So I walked into this house, and it was breathtaking. It was beyond anything I'd ever seen in my life. And I immediately thought, I could be miserable here. give me 30 more seconds, and I could find something to complain about. So as much as I...
Yeah, the complacency that comes from being very wealthy can be paralyzing, and it can be infantilizing, and it can make you very unhappy. I have seen firsthand wealthy people living, you know, miserable lives. It's true. Needing to pay your rent. This goes back to the millennial thing. Needing to pay your rent, knowing that you need to take care of yourself and others, I think really does make you a happier person.
Although a condominium on a ship, I would have a massive panic attack on a cruise ship. I just would feel trapped, and there isn't enough Valium in the world to help me deal with the fact that I am out at sea and I am on this boat for 2 weeks and there's no getting off.
No, you get off every day. They stop every day. Most of them, I mean, I did a crossing where it was 8 days not getting off, but most of them.
Any panic attacks?
Most people, no. Did I have a panic attack? A couple of times when I couldn't get internet. I did lose it a few times.
I get that. No, I just have never done that because if I was with people that I liked and knew, but you mostly go by yourself or some people that you don't know might be the other comics. And I would just, that would be... Is it 2 weeks? Two-week depression.
You could do it because you have the kind of act that could...
Yeah, I couldn't do the other 23 hours of the day, though.
Yeah.
I would get too sad.
Let me ask you a stupid question. So you're on the cruise ship.
Are we going to talk about Kathy Griffin? Because I got to go.
Yeah, we're going to talk about Kathy Griffin in a second. You're on a I've never been on a cruise. Could people live forever on an aircraft carrier that's been converted into a city?
You mean forever, sort of like...
How we deal with this climate change.
Oh. Well, how would they end... I mean, there's enough food for a certain amount of time, but how would they get the food?
Okay, I live in an apartment building. 16 stories, I would say, has 1,000 people living in it. In a way, it's a small little city, a little community. We all hate each other and fight and argue about, you know, garbage and leaks. If you went from it being vertical to horizontal and it floated, it would be a ship. They can build a ship with 1,000 people living on it forever and make a city out of it. Isn't that how we can deal with global warming?
That may be how the wealthy will deal with it.
Well, no, we have to worry about ourselves.
No, it's not going to be for us. I could go on because I've already, you know, I got the connections.
Jeremiah Tower, the chef.
Yes.
I had him on the show.
Okay. He's a great guy.
He's a great guy. Before he became a chef, he was designing underwater cities. He had patents. Underwater, suppose we just decide instead of colonizing Mars, we create these massive biodomes and we live under the sea. We can do that. Maybe this is a good thing. Maybe pulling out of the... All right.
But all it's going to do is it's going to separate the rich from the poor.
Even more.
Even better. What? Okay. Let's talk about Kathy Griffin.
All right.
I think she's an amazing stand-up comic. She is so funny. She really is. I went to see her. My friend Jeff Wills booked her at the Kodak Theater, and we went and watched her, and she did 90 minutes of material that was edgy, vicious.
What year was this?
Like 3 or 4 years ago. Gossipy, bits about Cher, bits about her mother. She made me laugh really hard. Unique. Nobody does what she does. What do you think?
I think she's very successful, and I admire that.
You're biting your lip.
I don't want to talk, but my issue with her and the treatment, I do think that she's been hit way harder because she's a woman. And I know that's going to annoy you.
Of course.
I do not think if a guy did that, she'd be, they've crucified her.
I think she was right for doing it. I think she was wrong for apologizing. I think the biggest
mistake. Apology killed her.
The biggest mistake you make is apologizing. What she did pales in comparison to what Donald Trump does every day. The kid, the youngest kid, they say, was upset by it. If that kid is upset by it, he's got other problems, you know.
I think it's real. I think that your kid would be upset by it.
I don't think so.
I do. I didn't.
That kid has Donald Trump for his father. He's seen and heard a lot worse.
There's two arguments to be made. I did not think it was funny. I got it. I thought it was stylistic. I thought she wanted to be trending, and I knew that that's what the intention smelled of. When they fired Gilbert Gottfried for his joke after the tsunami, that was funny. Okay, he got fired. He lost income, but his joke was hilarious.
Yeah, no, I mean, I'm 99% of the time.
It's Bruce Smirnoff. Hang on for 1 second. Bruce, you're on. Bruce, can you hear me? I'm trying to set up a time with him.
Gunsy Knivesy.
I can't hear
you. Got to talk about Morg. You got to ask him about that. That's an amazing story. Well,
I'm trying to get him. Are you there? I love this. All right. We'll try to get Bruce later. Bruce is our Miami correspondent.
Oh.
I try to check in with him once a week. Is he the funniest person?
So funny. And when I moved here, he was, I guess, had just moved back from Cali. And yeah, I saw him like nightly. It was fantastic.
Is there any funnier storyteller of horrific events than Bruce Smirnoff. What should I ask him about?
He has an amazing story about somebody dying at the beginning of his show.
Yes, he told it on my show.
Okay, it's the greatest story. I'll tell you later.
Okay.
Or look up the Bruce Smirnoff episode from like 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
In the middle. He plays all the condos. Have you done the condos?
Yes.
Yeah. Have you done them?
I worked with him 2 weeks ago in Florida.
I am going this Saturday to do a Jewish Federation show. But
good. In Florida?
Yeah.
Which one?
Boca.
Oh. Of course.
And what are the audiences like?
I have no idea. It's my first one.
It's like any temple. Don't worry about it. You'll enjoy it. They're rich, though. They're very, Boca ones, very stuck up. They're very old. You're doing it next week?
Yeah.
That means that these are people that stay. They don't come back for the winter.
Oh.
I mean, the summer.
Okay.
So
is that good or bad?
It just means they're really old.
Oh, God.
They're old?
Because people that are my age and like up to 70, you know, they come north in the summer. But, you know, when you get to be 80, 90, that's too much of an effort to come back and forth.
They're old and they're experts on everything. They're experts on comedy. Right?
Sure.
They can tell you everything you did wrong. Right?
Great. There's a meet and greet after.
And they don't want jokes about Judaism. They just want you to be smart. Right? Isn't that tends to be...
I don't know. I think if it's funny, they don't mind.
Yeah.
They're smart. That's what's fun. I mean, you can still have fun with them. Mm-hmm. You can still do a dirty joke as long as you don't say the actual body parts. You know, you have to actually say schmeckel or or putz or something like that. You know.
Now let me ask you too about being Jewish.
Sure.
Do you have interests, John, in anything other than reading? Do you have a hobby?
Oh. I like yoga. I like shooting a little basketball.
All right. That doesn't count.
No?
Yoga's a hobby. I give him that.
Yeah, I'll give him that. I'm going to ask you, because you're next. I'm going to ask you a couple questions before you go.
But no, not enough.
John,
other than going to college.
Where'd you grow up?
Newton, Massachusetts.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right.
Jew Central.
So, raised both parents Jewish?
Yes.
Okay. Did your father have hobbies other than reading?
I mean, he jogged.
Yeah, but that's kind of like what you do to stay alive, and yoga.
Yeah. I mean, he coached all our teams.
What do you consider a hobby? Having a workshop?
Now he does. I mean, he was an excellent optometrist, and later in life started doing...
Corey Kahaney's father invented the scratch, the scratch and sniff eyeglasses.
Oh. The
scratch-resistant lens.
Oh, that's great.
So you could scratch on the lens, and it would smell... Of whatever you wanted it to smell
like.
It was like, eyeballs. Remember the movie Polyester? I bought the eyeglasses that smelled like pizza. So whenever I was in the mood to smell pizza, I would scratch. Her father made a fortune on the scratch and sniff eyeglasses.
He wishes.
No, he's been...
Carol Leifer's father.
You don't want to know this.
Hang on for 1 second. Carol Leifer's father was an optometrist.
Oh, really?
And his first name? Seymour.
Oh, that's adorable.
Seymour.
Yes.
Seymour.
Perfect.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. So your father was...
Yeah. Painting, photography, and now drawing. So yeah, he's picked up a few hobbies.
He's retired?
He is retired.
Well, that doesn't count.
Well, he started the painting and the photography while he was still working.
Because the doctor said you have to prepare for something to do when you
retire. No, it was even before that. It was when we started going, I mean, photography has been a while.
But that's lenses.
True.
That doesn't count. How much
of probably hands-on parents. They didn't have time for a hobby.
Yeah.
And then when the kids
really
went off to college, he found things to do.
He wasn't putting boats in bottles.
No.
He didn't have a stamp collection.
No.
He didn't collect guitars.
No.
Maybe traveled. Like to travel.
He did a lot of traveling, lecturing, and
well, he's Jewish. Everybody, if you're Jewish, you lecture everybody.
Yeah.
Now you make a left. Go ahead, make a left, but then you're going to want to make a right.
What is not having a hobby a Jewish thing?
Well, I was trying to explain to a woman that sitting on the couch for 12 hours with your Kindle.
Yeah.
That's my hobby.
Yeah.
That's what I'm interested in.
Sure.
And I try to explain that perhaps it's a cultural thing, that that just reading all day might be your father. Well, you were in a boarding school.
No, but I wasn't, not for my whole life. My father was a huge reader.
Did he have a hobby?
No. Like he said, he jogged.
Yeah.
My father was a big reader, and he also wrote.
Yeah, my dad wrote a book. My dad, big reader too. Yeah.
So, given a choice, like we could go see this Wonder Woman movie, which is supposed to be fantastic, mm-hmm. or we could stay home and read. Chances are both your fathers would prefer to stay home.
No, my dad would love
to
go to the movie.
My dad loves movies.
Yeah, my dad
he
would
loves
love
movies.
Loves to sit there with the popcorn and
bad movies?
Any kind.
No, good movies.
But he liked the
in
action
the old
ones.
Theaters. There's two old theaters, and there's one in West Newton and one in Coolidge Corner in Brookline, and he'll go to those and
to see vintage.
No, like whatever's like it's sort of like the Angelica of here, you know, mm-hmm. like kind of like the good independent stuff. Yeah.
Are you married?
I am not.
You have a husband?
I do.
He's a good man.
He's a good man. He's not a divorce attorney.
No.
He's a lawyer.
Elder law.
For people who have been abused by their kids?
No, he does, you know, wills, estates. He does elder law. He does special needs. He does the heartbreaking stuff.
Will he sue a divorce attorney for me?
No, but you can certainly call him and ask him what's the best way to approach it if the guy's unreasonable.
Well, I'm unreasonable.
Probably.
I'm vindictive.
Do you pick your battles,
that's
David?
Some good
if you're going
though.
Through a divorce, you
got to
pick your battles. I mean, what is the most important thing? That you keep as much money as you can?
That ship has sailed.
Okay.
Just keep the podcast.
I want to be funny. And just.
And you think it's robbing you of your humor?
No, I want to be funny with opposing counsel. So I've written a couple of letters. I think it's funny to.
Did you see that the slave letter?
No.
It was popping around the internet. They found a letter that a slave wrote to his master who asked him to come back to work after he had served in the Civil War, which got him his freedom.
Bill Maher?
But it was very funny. He's like, actually, you know, by all rights, you owe me $11,000 because I worked for you for 25 years and you didn't pay me. And it was just,
That's
it was
great.
Very.
It's a real letter.
Real letter. Very funny.
I like it.
Now, has Snopes checked it out? Is it legitimate?
I don't know. I'll email you.
I can tell you're itching to go because you have a kid that you have to get to. You're 13-year-old. But your husband, before you go.
Oh, God.
His number.
Yes.
What's his number?
Oh.
No. I want to know that what I want to know about your husband, he's a lawyer. He worked for the Justice Department.
Right.
He's a great man.
Great guy.
I met him.
Yeah. Did you? Good.
Yeah. Great man. Saturday afternoon, flat on his back, reading.
No sports. Watches all sports. It's a sickness, and you know. And he puts away a lot of hummus and chips and salsa and chips and you know. I mean, you know, he'll go throw the ball around with my son. He goes to Little League and screams. Mm-hmm. He goes to watch my son play basketball. But I mean, during Saturday and Sunday. It's sports, and he texts Lenny Marcus the whole game, you know, especially when it's a Giants game.
Does he have a hobby besides sports?
No. I would say his hobby really is his kid. My husband has had to become a real, you know, hands-on parent since I started doing the ships. But he, you know, I didn't need a kid after my daughter was 20 years old. So the way I figure is you wanted this kid, you got to raise this kid. I was done.
I was driving with my sister up in Hamburg, New Jersey, saw all these farms, and I thought, it must be nice to be a Gentile. Rolling hills. I fantasize.
Oh, yeah.
You know, cows, chickens.
Just not getting nervous at the end of a meal when the check's about to go down. They always seem so cool, don't they? Like, I get into it. What's going to happen? They're going to take the credit card. They're going to split it. What's happening?
Not having to live in the dark.
They go to stores. They see something they like. They buy it. It's crazy.
I have this friend, John Ross, comedy writer, comedian, and he has a farm somewhere. And he's Jewish, and it's just not like, it just can't be, I have this farm. It's, I have this farm. And this chicken.
And the chicken is the best chicken, and it's a great chicken.
I wish I could do something other than be interested in things. Just, you know, leave, go, you know, have a farm somewhere.
But I think that a lot of the country sees what we're talking about as elitist. That when we say we don't have hobbies, we like to read, we like to be educated, we like to be inquisitive. Sometimes it comes off as though we are better than them. And we have to be careful of that.
Better than they.
Yeah. Okay.
Case in point.
Great.
Is anxiety a hobby?
Yes. Panic attacks, anxiety. Okay. I'm going to die alone.
That's my main.
It's finally occurred to me that I'm going to die alone.
Everyone is.
No, Muhammad Atta didn't die alone.
You have a kid, right? How many kids do you have?
Who's Muhammad Atta?
He flew the plane into the World Trade Center. His parents went, at least he didn't die alone. Dying alone. Mm-hmm. Doesn't that scare you?
Oh, every day.
You know what happened last time?
His whole act is about that.
Pretty much.
His whole act is about ending up alone.
Last night I was watching TV, eating a pretzel, lying. I thought, I better sit up because that's how I'm going to die.
Choke on a pretzel.
Choking on a pretzel, forgetting to remove the cookies on my laptop. He looked at that before he was looking at her?
I'm afraid that they're going to check my internet searches, and they're going to be like, she went to TripAdvisor 37 times. That's all she does.
To what, save $9? Nine?
All right, you guys,
all
thank
right.
you for
You'll
having
come
me.
Back?
I'd love to come back. I'd love to
Good
see
to
you
see
soon.
You. You're and, fantastic. You
oh,
really
you
are.
The, thank you. Too kind.
Come back.
All right.
Don't, you know what? Let me tell you something about going to see, you have a 13-year-old kid?
Yeah.
You know what? I got news for you. Show business you'll have for the rest of your life. A kid, they go off, you don't hear from them. Show business, stay with me. Let the kid go. Is it a boy or a girl?
Are you implying that I
You're
should
too
just
possessive.
Cut, I should cut ties?
13, he's a man.
He is.
Let him go.
I know, I gotta put a casserole in the oven.
Well, you're too attached to him.
It's my last chance at being a mom. You
mothers
know?
And sons.
So it's my last chance.
Mothers and sons, because the sons disappear.
I just talked to my mom on the walk from the subway to here.
You know, my son just had a bar mitzvah, and when he got to Mommy and Daddy's poem,
yeah.
He said, she's a pretty good cook when she's here. And she lets me drink champagne on the first of the year.
Big laugh.
Big laugh. And then he goes, basketball, football, baseball, and hockey. Daddy, you're the light in my storm when it gets rocky.
Pretty good.
Pretty good. Well, I wrote it. He had things that he wanted to say. He wanted to do the champagne because I let him. He was on a cruise with me. We were on a fancy cruise, and he's tall, so they kept giving him champagne. I said, "How many have you had?" He said, "I don't know." I said, "Well, how do you feel?" He says, "Good." And I said, you know, you're spoiled because they were serving Vovklikov. I said, you're never going to get this much champagne at this quality. So enjoy it.
Happiest day of your life, the bar mitzvah, right?
No, that's not the happiest day of my life.
I think it was the happiest day of my life going to your son's bar mitzvah.
I don't know. I hate when they say happiest day of your life.
There's something... I was very happy when my kids...
Yeah, I mean, it was a good day. It was a good day.
It was the thing...
The day my daughter was born was really a happy day. Letterman was, like, the greatest day.
What's the difference?
I don't know. It was. It took so much to get Letterman.
It was, and it's yeah. a. It's it a was personal
an
thing.
Epic effort, and to be a girl and get Letterman, it was even harder.
More important. It's better than having a baby.
It was really up there.
Did you have an epidural to do Letterman?
One of the best days of my life. It really was a good day. They went to the Palm afterwards.
Really?
And Jackie the Joke Man was there, and he bought me a drink, and I don't know. It was a great day.
And did you talk to Dave?
Insofar as he was very nice. He held my hand for a long time because I was shaking at the end of it. And he could see that I needed that, and he just kept holding. And he said, very funny. And then 15 minutes afterwards, Billy Burr texted me. He goes, you got very funny. Fuck you.
That's, that's even better.
Yeah, it was a really nice. He was so sweet to do that. Yeah. And that was a great. I mean, for you, wasn't it like one of the greatest days?
I had an amazing day because I am so anxious that, you know, my parents live in Boston and my dad was going to come down. And I said, I don't know if I can handle the anxiety of you taking a train or driving here that day. I can't worry about that. And he was like, okay, okay, okay. But he's like, he's my call if I'm nervous for a show or something like that. So I call him, you know, before, and then afterwards I call him and I'm like, he's like, how'd it go? I'm like, it went great. He's like, I'm outside. He traveled down without telling me to meet me right after. Yeah.
Did he see you do it?
No. But I had shows back in Boston, so he stayed over that night. We drove back, and then I watched it with my parents.
Oh,
he was there right when I got out.
He was the warm blanket. Yeah.
Hang on. I'm getting the chills. Yeah. Not from that story. I have malaria.
Moody McCarthy was with me, and he was crying when he saw my dad.
Okay, so tell me this story.
I'm crying.
I
want to
hear
up.
This. See, okay. Stay for 1 second. I want to hear. Then you can leave. Tell me the story.
I was too nervous to be worried about my dad's travel coming down. As I was trying to focus on the Letterman set that mm-hmm. day. So he said, okay, I won't come. So I did the set. When I finished, I called him. He asked me how it went. I said, it was great. He said, I'm outside the studio. He had taken the Amtrak down to surprise me for right after, but he didn't want me to see me. He didn't want me to see him beforehand to make me nervous.
So he was there for you just in case you bombed?
Pretty much. No, he, you know, in his head, he was like, I'm going to go...
congratulate
yeah.
him.
I'm going to go congratulate him. I don't need to see it. I don't need to sit in the audience. I'm here for you.
He knew that would make me too nervous, yeah.
What an asshole. He didn't even get
But when I did Colbert, so I had beautiful. Them come down, and they're like, you're not going to be nervous? I'm like, first of all, I'm not going to... What can make me more nervous than this, you know? And I was thinking in the 10 years in the future, like, I would want them to see
right.
one of these, so... I
right.
dealt with that anxiety.
So you went outside
mm-hmm.
and you saw your dad.
And brought him in. And
you brought him in. Did you introduce him to anybody?
Well, Paul was out when we got to go back out to take pictures and stuff, which he did with his very nice camera. It's one of his hobbies.
Yes.
And, you know, we were all out. Yeah, so he met, you know, everybody that he could, and it was great.
That sounds like one of the greatest days of your life.
It was really great.
See, what was great about mine was I did not want my parents to ruin it. And they just happened to be in from California. And so my sister, because she loves me, bit the bullet. And she did the cover story, it's not that big a deal.
Uh-huh.
And let's go out to dinner. And she kept them away.
Good, good,
but
good,
I had
good.
Ariel there, my daughter. And I had my baby sister went. Because I knew they knew how to... you know, how to show up for me.
It's so good to have that.
And because my parents would have, you know, we don't know where to sit. We don't know what to do. It's too cold. I don't know. Is it okay if we come back? Is there peanuts? I didn't want them to ruin it.
Yep.
And I had Ross with me. Ross Bennett was backstage.
Yeah.
As my...
Eddie Strange.
Formerly known as.
Yeah. We have to have Eddie on this
show. Oh my God. He was amazing.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
He was amazing. And then right before the show, I called Johnny Lampert.
Nice.
Because I was freaking out, and he goes, "All right, I'm saving this for you." You know, he's a terrible booker. He's a sweet guy. He's a great booker. He's a character. But he goes, "You just think to yourself, this is a Johnny Lampert gig, and you're and you're being very underpaid, and it's going to make you so mad that you're going to kill."
Wow.
And it was the best image. You know, funny. He goes, "It's a temple, and you're getting $750, and you should be getting $15."
Wow.
That's hilarious. That's yeah, hysterical. I had Lenny with me for Colbert, and I was getting
Lenny
nervous.
Marcus.
Yeah, and I have this like you know gemstone thing for positivity that I wear as a bracelet. And he's like, "You can't wear that." And I'm like, "I know, but it's a good luck thing, kind of." And he was like, "Well, put it on your mother's wrist." Yeah, so that was good.
That's
Lenny's
sweet.
Good.
Lenny's
yeah,
great.
Lenny's great.
Lenny's great.
Yeah,
that's good to have a comedy buddy.
Yeah.
The first time I did Conan, Robert Schimmel stood with me.
Nice.
Yeah.
I hear he's a generous guy.
He was.
He was that. Talk about. We have to talk about Eddie Brill. Eddie Brill and Schimmel were very tight.
Right.
Yeah.
And my first talk show I did was with Dennis Miller's Tribune show. Dennis had a syndicated talk show that went up against Arsenio. And I was really nervous because I wanted to impress Dennis Miller. This was back when he was the shit. Now he's just... No. and my friend John Ross stood with me. And he said, "You're like a caged tiger." He said, "You could lift a car." I remember he said, "You could lift a car right now. You have so much adrenaline going through you." Did you have adrenaline?
So much, yeah.
Well, let me ask a woman a question.
Sure.
Is it anger that motivates you to get out there on the Letterman show? What is pushing you? Is it violent? Because for comics, for some comics, it's there's a violence to it. I'm talking about walking through that fire.
Right.
I think
my style of stand-up, though, is that I'm sort of this crotchety, you know, curmudgeon. I mean, that's really very much my act. And so my friend making me, you know, have an image of being, you know, annoyed or irritated did help. It was like, you know, the sand that you put under the skin and the, you know, that made the rhinoceros. I don't know.
Is it good for you in a pressure situation?
To be angry.
Yes.
Yeah. That's that will motivate me to just work through it. Oh, screw it. I'll just do it. Yeah.
Being angry is...
Too happy. I'm not so funny.
I'm the opposite. I'll never forget. I went out to do something once and I was very nervous and my friend tickled me. And it helped. He was in the wings, and he just sort of tickled me. And I was like...
You know, a lot of this is maturity, though. You know, I'm now at a point where, I mean, I could be sitting and eating a meal. I could probably get up and go do one of these shows. I had put so much pressure on that one that it was it was difficult.
But anger, being angry.
Anger is my motivator, for sure.
And is that through therapy you learn to channel anger into your comedy and use it as some kind of caffeine?
Well, I mean, I think anger was probably the core of all defense mechanisms for me as a funny person. I was always funny as a kid.
Yeah, it coincides with your stage presence.
Can you be funny if you're not angry? Can you be funny if you're not angry?
Now I can. Yeah, now I can.
But you're tapping anger. You're faking anger.
Yeah, sometimes. Sometimes I just change it to lightly annoyed, lightly irritated, slightly, you know, this could be better.
Growing up. Do you remember dinners? Do you remember your family sitting around fighting just because it was funny? Arguing just because it was funny? Maybe not screaming, but yelling because it was funny. And nobody, it was harmless.
Teasing,
but getting into an art. Do you remember uncles or neighbors who would come over and you'd be eating dinner and the uncle or the aunt would take an opinion just to excite everybody and get everybody screaming?
No, I think we all had a glaze of let's not go there. It was all like, let's just keep this like this thing that's kind of good. And because, I think things might have exploded too much. We wouldn't have been able to do what you're saying.
Well, political discussions,
anything.
Perhaps. See, I remember...
My family was very funny. All of my aunts did accents. They all did great accents. So, you know, to break tension, I mean, sometimes she'd do the Queen of England or she'd do the Russian character. My mother, oddly enough, could do Sid Caesar. So she could do that sort of like...
Oh, the double talk.
The double talk.
Wow.
And my mother could do a great German accent. And so there would be a lot of, you know, pass the potatoes now. And give me your papers. I mean, it was a lot of acting stuff. And my, you know.
That's funny.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, there was a lot of funny. Sometimes people would stay in character, especially for some reason, the Indian. I'm sorry, anybody who's Indian, but we could do Indian for an hour, you know. what is it you don't want to eat this? there are people starving in our house. You
know? That's funny.
Yeah, there was a lot of laughing for sure. Uh-huh. I think you know, my mother was really great at accents, and my father was very dry humor.
You grew up in a silly household.
Well, there was definitely. I mean, there was a lot of fighting, but the way that it would get diffused was through humor. So I think I mimicked that at a very young age.
Did you grow up in a silly household?
Yeah.
How many brothers and sisters?
I just have one brother, and so it was me,
older,
my brother,
or younger?
And my dad. He's younger, and we all had the same sense of humor. And I always later felt bad for my mom in retrospect that she had to deal with us.
All right, let's plug some gigs. This was fun. We're good? Let's plug some gigs. Where are you going to be?
Go. You got to go.
I'm going. I'm not.
Corey Kahaney.
Yes. CoreyKahaney.com is my website if you want to go to it. And you can, on iTunes, I have an album for purchase, and it's called Corey Kahaney TV Clean.
Great.
And feel free to contact me. I'm available for parties and...
July 23rd, I'm going to be headlining the Fat Black Pussycat Lounge, the Comedy Cellar there.
Can you stick around for 10 more minutes?
Sure.
Bye, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Good to see you.
And say hello to Bruce Mirnoff.
I will. Oh, yeah. I will. Because I didn't have time to talk to you.
Yeah.
So when did you start doing comedy?
December of 98.
December of 98.
Yeah.
And growing up, who were some of your influences?
Well, like I said, my father, my brother, and I, we all had the same sense of humor. My aunt, my brother's sister, very funny. Comedian-wise, I really started watching in high school. My dad and I would watch, I remember us watching the HBO specials of, like, Seinfeld, Roseanne, right around there.
Mm-hmm.
All that, like, A&E Comedy on the Road stuff was playing, and I would like get home to watch that at whatever time that was, like 11 p.m. or 1 a.m., whatever.
And who
it was.
Stood out?
Dennis Wolfberg.
The late Dennis Wolfberg, yeah. Yes.
The guy, Scott LaRose?
Scott LaRose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He does a lot of commercials.
Yeah, you know?
I found him hilarious. Adam Ferrara.
Mm-hmm. We just had Adam on the show. Yeah.
Adam Ferrara was somebody that I just... And then when I started doing comedy, it was like, oh, that's a guy who's a writer and a performer.
Right.
And I was just always really impressed with him because he had this material and he would just like command the stage.
Adam Ferrara.
Adam Ferrara. Yeah. And he hosted my New Faces up in Montreal.
Wow.
So it was really cool.
Yeah. So you grew up watching the comedy explosion.
Yes.
See, when I
DePaulo.
Was... DePaulo. Oh, Nick DePaulo. We were trying to get him back. We're just... scheduling conflicts. Have we heard anything? Okay. Well, of course he's a pain. That's what makes him so funny. It's interesting. When I was growing up, I was influenced by Carlin, Steve Martin, Woody Allen, Mel Brooks, Carl Reiner, Pryor, and they were teaching me what was funny. I didn't judge them. There was no judging comedy back then. Tom Dreesen would come on The Tonight Show, George Miller, David. You go, oh, okay, that's how you be. I never had a critical eye watching these people. They were teaching me what was funny. Were you critical? Was your father critical when you watched this?
Just pure enjoyment at that time.
Laughing.
I mean, that was high school. And then I remember going to college, and there was just a comedian there. And I had no aspiration. I didn't know I could do that. So I didn't have room for aspirations.
What did you think you were going to do? What did you think you were?
I thought I was going to be a psychologist or a psychiatrist or something suburban, you know? And then this comic came and I was like, ugh, I could do that.
Right.
But it still didn't get the ball rolling until I graduated. And that's when I started watching more... like you were just describing of like, how do I do this? And that was like when Dr. Katz was on and Andy Kindler became,
Andy Kindler.
Yes, we have a shared love of Andy Kindler.
Everybody loves Andy Kindler.
And Jonathan Katz and I said, when he went to he did a show at the Newton JCC where he did stand up. I think he had Bill Broadus opening for him and he did, you know, a show and then he talked about Squiggle Vision and stuff and showed some of the episodes and stuff like that. And that was
have you met Jonathan?
Have I met him? I don't know if I've met him. I think I've been in the same room as him, mm-hmm. like when he came to the comedy studio in Boston, right. but I don't think I ever shook hands with him.
Yeah. He's pretty
from the same hometown.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is he a fan of your show?
Oh, I spoke to him. Awesome. Yeah, I don't.
I feel like you were probably on Dr. Katz.
Yeah.
I mean, like all of you guys, like I would know before I ever met. And I mean, I remember loving your Conan set. I think I was already in New York, and you came to prep it at Luna. Mm. Maybe.
Yeah.
Is that possible?
Jeff Singer.
Yeah. That was great. Andy Kindler, and who was the other? I don't know, just that whole thing that was amazing to me, because I was loving stand-up, and then I was like, oh, here's this other way to present it.
Right.
That was so cool. And I was learning that those were actually their stand-up mm-hmm. bits. He made it, that's hard to do, to take stand-up out of stage and microphone and put it into another format and make it palatable.
You mean like a cartoon?
Yeah.
My happiest memory was I did an episode of Dr. Katz, and there's a joke where I say, you know, I'm a great parent. I change the cat box before my children play in it. Okay, so they, instead of a sandbox, they play in the cat. There, we recorded 20 minutes of material, and then my Dr. Katz is airing, and my kids were like 5 and 4, I don't know, you know. And they all gather around with their friends to see Daddy on Dr. Katz because it's a cartoon.
Can I just say, literally, when I would watch you, I would be like, I wonder if he lets his kids see this.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Because it's all lies. Yeah, it was all lies.
I know.
There was nothing. And I'm sitting there reading the newspaper. They're watching Dr. Katz. And I put the newspaper down and I wonder what Jonathan picked, and this is going to be interesting. And there's this scene of my kids in a cat box playing with each other while the cats are outside of the box waiting to use it after my kids are done playing in this filthy cat box. And one of my kids goes to their friend, "That's us. That's us playing in the cat box.
We're on TV.
We're on TV." And I'm thinking, well, that's got to be damaging down the line. It's just a cartoon of you playing in piss and feces-soaked toxoplasmosis. But, it was just a happy memory of... Yeah, I think kids can be exposed to anything except the truth. That's my... my kids would come and watch me, and I got into trouble once for saying that one of my kids was smart, funny, and pretty. And I was called up and said, "How dare you say that? How dare you call me smart, funny, and pretty?"
Well, that was the upsetting thing?
And I said, "I thought our deal was that I can't say anything about you that..."
It's true.
That's true.
That's not funny. That's not...
Yeah, I'm not allowed to say anything that's true about my kids. By the way, I love my kids.
Yeah, no, I met your
daughter. I'm saying that's the joke.
Oh, got it.
That's why I say I love. You met my daughter.
Yes, at the Carlin street naming.
Oh, yes, she worked there. Yes. I she's interested in comedy, and I said, you know, you can't be a stripper like every other daughter who had emotionally unavailable fathers. You have to do stand-up and break my heart. Just go be a stripper. Yeah. I didn't say that.
I was trying to think of the other one, but it was someone else and Kindler that like watching their Dr. Katz thing off of one of their setups, I wrote my first joke.
Oh, what was your first joke?
He had something about, you know, just something like, you know, I quit drinking. And then he went somewhere else. And in my head, I thought he was going to... So I said, "I quit drinking. Boy, am I dehydrated."
That's a great... That's your first joke?
Well, the first thing that I actually wrote down. Like, I was, you know, starting to look to take a workshop, you know. Mm-hmm. And that was...
Now, where'd you write down? On a napkin?
I think I had...
Yellow legal pad?
I think I had a notebook of index cards. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a little bigger than your standard index.
And do you still have them?
I'm sure. Yeah, that's definitely in my...
What do you keep? What do you hoard from stand-up? Are you a hoarder of
set lists? Yeah, I have some old... the Comedy Connection in Boston, which was like the big club that I started at, would have these like, you know, flyers always. And I have some of those with like guys like, you know, Gallman, Paul Nardizzi, Kevin Knox, Gavin, Don Gavin. So I have like pictures of these guys still. And yeah, I've got, you know, piles and piles and drawers of notebooks.
You don't throw that out. It's interesting because your generation, my generation, is rubbing up against our parents who are hoarders. They don't throw anything out, and we don't want it. I think the antique roadshow was invented by our parents to convince us that hoarding is...
bad.
A virtue.
Oh, a virtue. I mean, my dad definitely is. I have it too. My brother totally doesn't. Like, my dad has to go through all this stuff. It's like his weekend chore. My mom wants him to get rid of stuff, and he'll have like a new pile for me every time I go and visit, and it's like hard for me to throw it away. My brother doesn't even need to see it. He's just like, yeah, chuck it.
Well, you know, I'd like to say I'm like your brother, but one of the things I do is I have a nervous breakdown room, or I have a closet. In other words, I just gather up the things and I just throw it all into one area, and it doesn't exist.
Right.
But I cannot be around clutter. I hate clutter.
Yeah.
I hate things. Ever since I got thrown out of the house, we had things. Years go by. My things were put in storage. I moved to New York. Now I have nothing.
And it feels
better. Know that the things I know that, and as the years go on, I keep thinking, well, what am I missing that's in that storage bin? I have a hockey puck signed by Don Rickles that I want. I have a Mark Twain first edition that was given to me by a comedian, and then everything else. You know, if it got torched, if you just set fire to that storage facility,
I kind of want to tell my dad, don't even show it to me.
Mm-hmm.
And because if I know it's not, you know, it's just a memory. The other thing we started to do is like, so it's like, gotta have pile. Let's take a picture of it and get rid of it.
Mm-hmm.
Pile has been a helpful
thing.
What
do you hold on to from, like, what are, you know, you're in your apartment. There's a fire. What are you going to grab?
There's not much in my apartment. Yeah. I mean, there's like this, I have this cactus mirror wall hanging thing that my parents had in their first apartment in Arizona when I was born, which I kind of I've had in all my apartments.
What have you saved from your first Letterman?
I have
the thing
cue
on the
cards.
Door. The thing on the door. Do they put like your name on the door?
I didn't get that.
Okay. I took the door. You can keep the little adhesive with my name on it.
No, I still have the bag, you know, that they give you your little gifts.
Yeah.
Yeah, like the mug and the... And right. I think I gave the hat to my dad, and the T-shirt might still be in there. Yeah.
The cue card where they introduce
cue cards,
you.
Yep.
Did you get him to sign it?
I didn't get him to sign it, and I also never had it mounted and framed, but I still have them. Yeah. I think I have. I've got a poster from the first time I headlined Gotham, rolled up in the tube somewhere in one closet. Yeah, I got little stuff. I got VHS tapes that I haven't thrown away.
How many jokes do you write a week?
Oh, God. Ideally? I mean, I try to write for 2 hours a day.
Really?
Yeah, that's ideal.
What do you mean you write for 2 hours a day?
I do free write for 30 minutes.
What does that mean?
Like an artist's way, like just open up my notebook and... If I get right to it, like I want to in the morning, 3 pages.
And what do you write?
That's just free. That's just like a meditation almost, just like get it all out. And that helps me like then write jokes. So I'll do like if I'm writing, you know, jokes for my act or jokes for like monologue jokes, if I'm trying to put a packet together, like try to do 2 hours of something.
Uh-huh.
Like And then, but
that's in the artist's way, they say to do that?
The 30-minute thing. It's called the morning pages, yeah.
Morning pages.
Yeah, but, you know, half the time it's, I did them on the subway here at 3 o'clock, you know. And so if I don't get to it first thing, two pages is what I can usually get on my subway commute, so I do 2 pages.
And is there anything in that you...
Sometimes I'll star something, but that's not the goal. But I'll star something.
The goal is just to write.
Just to get it all out of my head. And then that what helps me is...
Do ransom notes count?
Sure.
Okay.
Those are the best. It helps me like later.
See, I was going to kidnap somebody, but I had writer's block. I couldn't come up with the ransom. Did somebody do that joke?
No, that's great. That's your warm-up exercise.
Is that a joke? Alex says it's a joke.
You got a joke? I'm bringing back quit drinking. This has been very productive. But it does help when I like put down the thing that I was like trying to force write during that 2-hour block,
mm-hmm.
and between the free write and the 2-hour block, then when I go and just like sit with a setup, it really helps to like get something. So like that time where you're just, you know, a half hour before your set, when you're just kind of looking over things. And
I find that curious because I'm convinced that nobody can actually write stand-up. It has to be materialized through conversation.
That's what I'm saying. So it's like those are like conversations with myself, and it's sort of like my forcedness that nothing rarely comes from.
So you're saying rereading things that you wrote are like a conversation with yourself.
Or even when I'm just writing, that's mm-hmm. what I'm doing. Not the free write, the other things. It's like, oh, here's the things that are in my notebook from like, or emails that I emailed myself that something funny happened
right.
in a conversation or that I noticed. And then I'll kind of write about that. And then sometimes something funny will happen, like it'll be in joke structure, but it really comes from, like you said, like being on stage or like right before, like kind of going over it and then like having a conversation with myself.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Writing, we got to wrap it up, but I think what you're saying is you write something, get it on the page. It doesn't have to be funny. It doesn't have to be good. Get it on the page. And then you're actually collaborating with yourself if you come back in a day or two with fresh eyes and you see something that you wrote and you don't recognize, and suddenly you can be your own writing partner.
Yeah, or the walk, you know, after you're done at the coffee shop or whatever. It's like, or the shave, you know, or the shower. That's like you're thinking about what you just wrote
down. Some
of
the best jokes I've ever written have come up while I'm shaving my legs. I don't know what it is about shaving my legs, but having a look at my ankles in the mirror,
imagine.
It's just, yeah, it's just something happens. Well, this is great. You'll come back?
Yeah, man, this is great.
This was great.
Thanks for having me.
Jon Fisch is a stand-up comedian. Watch for him on Colbert, on Comedy Central. Do you have a website?
JonFisch.com, JonFisch. And Johnny Fish is my Twitter.
Johnny Fish is your Twitter. Say hello to your brother, White. It's a Jewish joke, White Fish. Thank you.